director of iStrategy's labs, and he's shaping, I think, what iStrategy's doing worldwide is shifting the concept and actually doing quite a lot in marketing, and how we advertise and how we change the consumer experience on advertisement and marketing. And for the general public, I just want to tell you that iStrategy Labs did the campaign for the launch of Mr. Robot, and I think that we have quite a lot of fans over here at BONEVET. I will just call Mark for a few sentences, a few words, just to introduce more about the series of how Mark came to Kosovo and what the U.S. Embassy is doing. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you very much, and thank you for having us. Just wanted to say very briefly, my name is Mark Naylor. I work in the Embassy in the Public Affairs Office. We brought Peter here to Kosovo because we were very excited to talk about the connection that's starting to happen here in Kosovo between technology and entrepreneurship. And our goal is to continue to highlight where Kosovo can be headed in the future. With great partners like BONEVET, we've been working since the beginning with BONEVET, and we're so excited to bring a speaker here, but continue to think about programs in the future, because centers like BONEVET are absolutely the future of helping people develop skills in Kosovo that you can use to build a brighter future for Kosovo, to grow the economy, but to make tangible things. And that's frankly what I really love about BONEVET. You're not just giving skills and training, but you're making tangible things. There's something that at the end of the day, all of you can show to say, look at what this place can do for you. So I don't want to take any more time other than to say, please give a warm welcome to Peter, and thank you all for being here.
How you doing? Good. How many people are from Yakovo? Almost everybody. Anybody from Christina? None? Anyone? Okay, so I can say this safely. I heard that the smartest people in this country were in this city. Is that true? That's what people keep saying. They're like, yeah, when you go there, you're going to be really the smart people. Don't tell anyone in Christina that I said that. So I figured what I would do is give you a little bit of context on who I am and sort of my entrepreneurial journey of growing this company, but also show you some really fun work we've done. Our focus is on quote-unquote hacking the online and offline world. So we make things in the digital and the physical space. I could show you Mr. Robot work. Who's watched the show? Holy crap, I've done my job. People that have watched the show. That's amazing. Ever watched through season two yet?
Yeah.
Yes. All right. So that case study is not in my current slides, but I'll bring it up if you really want to see it. So we did all of the marketing work for the launch of season one and for season two of Mr. Robot. And I don't always get to come up with the ideas for these campaigns, but in this case I did. So you're meeting the guy that has marketed the show that you love. Which is not, you don't always get to do that. So I'll tell you all about it if you like. I love the show, and it's been great. So anyway, context. So I'm the CEO of iStrategy Labs, ISL for short. And I have a sort of a varied background, these four things that kind of come together. So I'm very much an entrepreneur, but I grew up as a programmer, and then as a designer, and as a producer. So when I say producer, I mean I was a TV producer, so making, you know, video for TV, and also a concert producer. So in college, the first business I started, just throwing big concerts. 5,000 people would show up, come listen to some music, have a good time. And so I learned a lot about how people interact in physical space, how to use content to get people excited, how to use technology and creativity to change minds. So that's basically what I do. How many people in the room are already entrepreneurs or want to? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10, 12, and everybody else is going to work for them, right? Those are the CEOs. Remember those hands, right here up front. CEOs, love that. So most high school students,
yeah.
College, adults, you can be both at the same time. okay, that's good to know. So we call ourselves a full-service digital agency. Digital is not really, it kind of puts us in a box, because as much as we work with pixels and code, we also work with atoms, and I know you guys work with atoms a lot here, and that especially, as I said, is this focus of online and off. And actually, I'll say the reason why, sometimes, why did you decide to focus on the intersection of online and off? And I think I was lucky. 9 years ago, I got fired from job. Most people don't say lucky and then fired from a job in the same sentence. But I got lucky. I got fired from a job. And at that point, it was a Friday. I got fired on a Friday, of course. Locked me out the door. Locked me out. Throw me out. And I obviously, I got drunk that night with my friends. And I'm not advocating, especially for younger people in the room, to do that, but I did. And I woke up on Saturday not feeling so good. And I realized I didn't want Monday to come around and for me not to have a story. I didn't want the story to be that I got fired. That's not the best story, right? And so what I did was that Sunday, I built a crappy WordPress website, came up with a dumb name for a company, made an ugly logo, and put it on the internet. Like, that was literally the founding of the company. The reason I disparage it and say ugly and dumb, that's because it didn't really matter. Like, it did not matter what the idea was, or what the name was, or what it looked like. What mattered was I was going to do something, anything, and I had no idea what that was going to be. I just knew that I didn't want to get a job. Like, how do I not get a job? At the time, my cost of living, I don't know what the cost of living here is in your household. Maybe monthly cost of living, 200, 300 euros, something like that. So yeah, I had like 900 euros in the bank. And I thought, how do I make 300 euros every month so that I don't have to go move back in with my parents? Because that was like the equivalent as a 27-year-old at the time. I was sort of like dying. I was like, oh, I don't want to die. I'm gonna die, and I love my parents, that's great, but moving back in with your parents after you moved out, not so cool, especially when you're a single guy. You want to go on a date, you're like, I have to go home, my mom is worried about me, like, that's not the best. So I decided if I could do something where, you know, it's not just digital, because there are plenty of people doing, you know, web design, and, you know, that had been happening for almost 15, 20 years. And I knew that there were people that did that better than me. I couldn't compete. And then there were people who did experiential, right? These are people who produce concerts and stunts and those kind of stunty campaigns you see on YouTube, maybe. And I was like, but no one that I know is doing the intersection of those things. The digital people don't know how to make physical things. The physical people don't know how to make digital things. I can do both because I grew up doing both. So maybe that's why I can stand out. It turned out that was a good idea. And today, after 9 years, got about 85 employees, no investors, never raised any money. I started with 900 euros, or equivalent of that, roughly. And there's three teams, strategy, design, and hardware and software, and these are sort of combined teams. And 2 months ago, I sold the company to a publicly traded holding company. So, sold it for a tremendous amount of money, amount that I never thought that I'd ever see in my life. And you'll ask later, maybe, like, why did you do that and all the rest. I can talk about that, but I'll just say it up front. The reason why I didn't grow up wealthy, I grew up with a single mother with three kids, and she was essentially a waitress for a lot of my upbringing. And if I wanted money to buy candy or a video game, I had to figure out how to make it. So when you grow a company and you realize, like, okay, if I sell it, here's my chance to, like, never slip back into, like, not abject poverty, but, like, I never slip back into starting over again. You start to think, maybe I should sell this thing. And I'm 36, so I've got time to do something else if I screwed up and sold too early. Not a big deal. So over that 9-year period, worked with 21 of the Fortune 500. These are companies you probably know. Volkswagen, and Ford, Google, Facebook, General Electric, Disney, Red Bull, a whole bunch, right? And so I'm going to show you some of the stuff that we've done for them, and we call this, you know, hacking experiences. And depending on your context, hacking is a good thing or a bad thing. When I say hacking, I don't mean like breaking other people's computers or stealing their stuff. I mean making something. So hacking for me is making. It's inventing. And so we like to invent new experiences for people. And you're going to see some of those. And I think that's my job. So my job has been to come up with new things that get people excited, maybe change their mind, maybe get them to buy a product or a service, because that's how, that's our business model. Big companies hire us to get you guys or anybody excited about a TV show or something like that. So this is my good colleague, Zach Goodwin. He's my executive creative director. So he's the guy that makes all of the things look great, right? And the reason I show a slow-mo video of him getting punched in the face is because sometimes I want to do that. You know, when you have a collaborator who you've worked with for 7 years, you have some arguments. Hopefully they're constructive. But really the reason I show it is because, well, it makes me laugh. But then two, the ideas we create, that's what we want them to do. So I had someone come in and said, Peter, we'd really like you to come up with a good idea for this. And I said, I don't know how to do that. I'm not going to come up with a good idea. A good idea is boring to me. I need a great idea. The idea's got to just punch you in the face. It's got to change. It's got to like wake you up, get you excited about something. And so I want to show you sort of inside our workshop, first of all. So the company has a 20,000 square foot former factory as our office, which I can never do the meter conversions. Is it like 9,000 square meters? Is it like 7,000 square meters? 6,000 square meters? What's the whatever? Who's studying math in the room? Standard metric conversion. Anyway, it's a big place. How many square meters do you have here? 700? Yeah, we're probably
0.3333, one meter tall feet.
Okay, so
it's three, a big place. 3 feet, 1 meter.
So it's a big place. And inside there we had this workshop, which I thought was cool until I came here. This is fucking cool. I'm gonna probably curse off because that's what I do. But try and hold back. I don't want to offend anyone. Does that offend anyone?
No.
Okay. So this is inside the workshop. You might wonder where the connection is between this place and like economic opportunity or job or whatever. My team members, there's five of them full time that do this kind of work, and then there's a 20-person engineering team. The makers, I think their average salary is about $75,000 a year. We get paid a tremendous amount of money to make these things. So you may not realize it or not, but like learning how to do this here is a key skill in the world. I don't know if you knew that. I think you probably know that. I know that, because I hire those people all the time, and they're not the easiest to find, even in the US, right? And so keep in mind, it's not just fun. We're not just making little, like, oh, we plug a LED into a board. Okay, that's cool. Learn how to do that, and then you'll do a project like this, and ideally, and I don't mean to be like too money focused, but like, do stuff like this and you get paid, like in a real way, right? So, I'm going to show you some of the stuff that we've gotten paid to do. Who knows what Budweiser is? Has anyone seen that brand or heard of the brand?
Beer.
It is. Which I think Wikipedia is better, frankly. Budweiser is, it's like, it's not that great. But they said, Peter, we heard about you guys. We heard you know how to invent weird things for the digital and physical world. We want you to create a new way for us to interact with consumers, because our consumers are these 21 to 35 year olds, or a lot of people drink Budweiser, more than that, but that's a core group of people that, you know, they want to get excited about the brand. So what would you do? Because these consumers are, you know, they're using Facebook all day, and Instagram, and Snapchat, and Uber, and all sorts of mobile applications that are different. But Budweiser still sells beer in a can, in a case, in a store. So what do we do? So we said, we've got an idea. This is what we should do.
Ever wish you had a way to keep track of the number of beers in your fridge and never run out? Well, now you can with Beer Minder.
Beer Minder is the latest advancement in beer inventory tracking. It uses light and temperature sensors to keep tabs on every beer can or bottle in your fridge. The Beer Minder rack syncs with its app via Wi-Fi, providing a real-time overview of your beer stock, status, and fridge conditions. Push notifications tell you when your beer is ready to drink, and can even sync with your social calendar to remind you to get more beer for special occasions. You also have access to beer delivery through Drizzly and Instacart. By using the Add Beer button, you can instantly have a 6, 12, or 18-pack delivered to your door, so you never have to leave the house.
Now, thanks to Beer Minder, you'll always have a cold one.
Okay. Now, if anyone asks you, maybe your dad asks you, why are you learning how to make that? So I'm like, I'm going to keep your beer cold, Dad. Don't worry about it. You always know. You always know if there's a cold one. So sometimes we do things because our clients hire us to make those projects. Other times we do it just for fun. And when we do that, they're really a lot of fun. We launch experiments every 2 months or so. There is a $25,000 R&D budget in the company that no one controls. Anyone can spend the money. I don't approve the budgets. People just use it and order stuff, and the stuff shows up at our lab and people make things. But we don't do that just because we want to set money on fire. Though that's kind of fun. We want to see, like, what's a little taste of the future? Like, how can we pull the future into the present just a little bit? Can we create something that people might like? Can we put this thing on the internet and see what happens? And then maybe, like, we turn it into a product, or, you know, someone hires us to, like, take it forward or whatever. So this one I'm going to show you, probably one of our most well-known experiments. And I don't imagine you know what all the like US TV shows are, like especially the morning shows. But this project got us on Good Morning America, The Today Show, Ellen. You guys probably know Ellen.
Yeah.
Ellen talked about this on her monologue in the start of the show. I was like, oh my God. And then on our national radio, NPR, New York Times, Wired, a whole, like everything. So here we go. This is Dorothy.
Meet Dorothy, the latest development in wearable technology, connecting your shoes to your phone. Dorothy is comprised of a mobile application that syncs with the Ruby, a small Bluetooth-enabled microcontroller powered by a light blue beam. Going on a first date? Select receive a call, create a fake contact, and slip the Ruby in your shoe. Now, when things get unbearable, click your heels together 3 times and answer that pressing phone call from your boss.
Oh, sorry, my boss is calling. I've got to take this.
To a single use case. Want to let your friends know where you are? Simply choose text 3 friends and select 3 buddies from your contact list. Clicking your heels together 3 times sends a brief message broadcasting your current location, letting your friends know exactly where you are. We're already refining our prototype to ensure the Ruby has a sleek, compact enclosure which will allow it to securely and discreetly fasten to almost any shoe. What else can Dorothy do? Summon an Uber? Order a pizza? We are hard at work exploring the depths of the if this, then that universe, so that the dreams we dare to dream really do come true.
Dorothy's kind of fun, right? So I should explain, assuming no one in the room has done marketing for a TV show, right? You're like, we have marketing, come on. Marketing a TV show is harder than anything else that I've done. And we've marketed cars and beer and jeans and food of all kinds and whatever. The reason it's so hard is because the campaign has to stick within the narrative of the show and can never break out of it, right? So anything that we do has to be like if Elliot would have said it, who's the main character, obviously those of you who know. Or like Mr. Robot himself, he would have said it or done it. And if the campaign would violate that narrative, it would destroy someone's, it would destroy your world. You don't want that. You're a Mr. Robot fan. You need to stay in that mindset. And so coming up with ideas that conform are just, it's really difficult. Part of what helped us was that we got to interact with the writers of the show and the director of the show to ensure that everything was in keeping, which is great. So, without further ado, this is the campaign.
Mr. Robot was a new series launching on USA Network, which followed the story of a young programmer who works at a cybersecurity firm by day and is a vigilante hacker by night. He is recruited by an underground hacker group to bring down the world financial system, erasing over 70% of the world's debt.
A single biggest incident of wealth redistribution in history.
To build awareness for the show with a young audience and immerse them in the themes of the series, we wanted to do something radical and to make a difference. We would delete $100,000 of debt live in real time. The debt deletion campaign was a custom interactive experience built for Twitch, a live streaming platform with 35 million monthly users. Twitch's tech-savvy audience was the perfect demographic for Mr. Robot, and the platform's innate social nature was ideal for leveraging reach and accessibility. We started the campaign by hacking into Twitch's live stream at the E3 gaming convention, the platform's most watched feed every year, with messages from F-Society, the fictitious hacker group from Mr. Robot.
Okay, it's back this year live from E3 2015, powered by Twitch, and
hello, friend. The time fraction's here.
Whoa, I have no idea what happened now.
We'll see you next year at E3 2016. Oh, there's one more thing.
We are our society. Over the next 48 hours, we will take control. Watch for our codes as we complete your debt in real time.
When E3 coverage ended, Twitch hosted the first 15 minutes of the Mr. Robot livestream, immediately attracting thousands of viewers. As our hackers migrated over to the Mr. Robot page, Twitch's viewers came with us, garnering over 19,000 concurrent streams. Over the course of a 17-hour livestream, we let the audience dictate the actions of our F-Society members, communicating in real time with the hackers via chat, Twitter, and Facebook. This real-time engagement proved to the viewers that the stream was truly live, was by far the most effective way of engaging with the Twitch audience. Twitch viewers were incentivized to host our stream, knowing that they could be called out live by our hackers. Throughout the activation, we saw over 2,700 people host our stream. Twitter was also a key player in the stream, with a potential reach of over 27 million people, and nearly 65,000 people tweeting at "Who is Mr. Robot?" over 3 days. Many of those tweets proposed challenges to our F-Society hackers, which were accepted moments later, live on set. Every 30 minutes, the hackers would reveal a new code, giving viewers a chance to reclaim a portion of the $100,000. 1,200 winners were announced live and paid out immediately via PayPal. Winners were encouraged to tweet about their bounty on social media, letting friends know that they had joined the Mr. Robot revolution and encouraging them to do the same. This campaign was full of firsts. Never before had a TV network used Twitch to present live original content. And those firsts translated into real success. The campaign saw over 1.4 million total stream views. 19,000 concurrent streams, 180,000 chat interactions, over 63,000 Twitter entries, and a total of 7.6 million minutes watched.
Sweepstakes rules were US Open. I couldn't do anything about it. I'm gonna show you one more thing. I'm not gonna take you through all these things. How many people are fans of SpongeBob? That was an enthusiastic hand raise back there. That was like 90% of the room, too. Any idea what the average age of the SpongeBob Facebook fan is? You win the prize, 34. Seriously, last time I did this, someone guessed 17, and I said multiply by 2. So Nickelodeon created it on SpongeBob, and they came to us and said, we need a new way to excite and delight the SpongeBob Facebook fans. Now, SpongeBob, I think at the time, had 44 million Facebook fans. They're probably like 55 or 60 million now. Usually top 10 most liked pages on the planet, right? And so the problem is, when the average is 34, you've got to create an idea that, like, everybody is going to love, right? Like, people younger than 34 and people older. So it's basically everybody. So how do you do that? I mean, that's almost as hard as marketing a TV show, I think. Creating something that is universal. Universal would be the word. And so, there's a lot of things that are universal to, you know, the human condition. That's how we start to think from a marketing point of view. Like, what's universal? You know, food and sex and shelter, all that stuff. I'm like, food and sex, that's not gonna work with SpongeBob. Shelter, like, we're not gonna build like a SpongeBob doghouse on the internet. What else is universal? Well, what else is universal is I realized that, like, almost everybody knows what an arcade is. Or they've been to an arcade to play games, right? Almost everybody. If you haven't, I think you even have one right down the street. I saw a big PlayStation banner outside. Okay, that's cool. Like, arcades are universal. There can be games involved. SpongeBob's a playful brand. But what else? What about arcades? How about that game, that like skill crane, that thing where you try to grab a prize and drop it in the little zone? Has anyone ever played that game? Has anyone ever won that game? No. You have?
Yeah.
Two of you? That's rare. Very rare. These are the lucky. Rub them. Rub their soul. So usually, if I ask that question in a room this size, no one will have won. It's usually, the room has to be at least like 500 to 1,000 people, and then I'll see like one or two hands. And you know why no one wins? So this is a makerspace, and so you like to think about things. The claw, you have a controller for the PSI, the pounds per square inch of grip, and the operators of the arcades can tweak the PSI and basically lower it so that it can grab anything and it just won't stick. So we thought, what if once and for all we could deliver joy in mass to the internet to let the internet win this game? If we could do that, every one of you who has never won that game, you'd want to win the game, right? Like, finally, you're going to win. So that's what we did. We decided to build an internet-connected skill crane game from scratch and live stream it over their Facebook page so anyone in the world could use it. And this is what it looked like in the end. Handmade. Every single piece of this thing was handmade. It gets installed on the Facebook page. On the left side, when you first come to the Facebook tab, and on the right side, this upper right-hand corner, that is streaming video, that's HD video, so you can see inside the crane. The actual device sat in a closet in our office, and we took a camera like that and just pointed it at the thing. And whoever basically answered questions fastest and popped all these little bubbles got control of it. Here it is.
What we made here was an internet-connected device to let hundreds of thousands of interact by for control of a skill crane.
There's a lot of
prototyping in many different ways.
We made all of the machine comps in SketchUp.
We actually started with metal rods and a very basic metal frame. A lot of the pieces that you see on the small machine were actually 3D printed right there in the lab.
The 3D printer became an integral part of our process, and I don't know that we could have actually pulled this off without it.
So the machine has two separate motors that control the X and Y axis, and one DC motor that controls up and down, and then a separate control that opens and closes the claw.
So we had a vast universe of SpongeBob objects to play with and draw from. It was a great challenge to make something that fit in both with the SpongeBob universe and was well designed for real life.
We started off by wireframing the interface.
Trying to lay out the experience for the user and where the buttons would go so people would explore a little bit as a part of the game experience.
One of the things we did was we brought in groups of college kids in subsequent sprints to make sure that we weren't just in our own echo chamber.
One of the major influences for how we dealt with mobile windows was derived from video game stuff. I've played plenty of video games, so I was pretty well informed.
Our backend development stack is using Mongo for the database. We use Redis to communicate from server to server. We then have three separate node server types.
We use shell scripts to spin up a large number of EC2s that would fire Phantom.js applications.
We learned that there are a lot of variables.
Still have a lot to figure out. But for us, I think it's really just the beginning.
SpongeBob, it got shipped to their house. People were very happy. There are a bunch of other things I can show you, but I want to get a sense for how much time I have. So what time?
Half an hour.
Okay, good. You guys want to see at least one more thing?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, I'm going to show you the selfie mirror.
Where is the selfie mirror? I actually have been presenting from absolutely the wrong deck, which is very funny, but I winged it.
I told you it'd be a lot of experiments. This is the folder of experiments. So let me show you the software. So I talked about how we just kind of make stuff. We just make stuff for fun to see if the world might like it. And if the world likes it, then we sort of take it forward. So the project that I'm going to show you was originally built in about 2 weeks. The cost of the components were probably $300 or so, which is a small amount of money for the experiments that we do. I mentioned the R&D budget is $25,000. So just $300 of that. Great, fine. Ignore the fact that there's a Mac Mini in here, because that's not $300. That's just something we took in the office and went back. So what we wanted to do is figure out, is there a new way to interact with social media? Like, everyone's trying to figure that out all the time, right? It's like, I'm gonna invent the next Snapchat or whatever. And we weren't thinking about inventing a new application. We wanted a physical device, because why not? We like to make physical things. So when we posted this to the internet, I think in about 2 days, 2 or 3 days, 75,000 people watched the video. And I think it was like 3,000 or 4,000 people emailed us wanting to buy one, which is kind of crazy. And then we ended up selling a bunch of them, but I'll talk about that after I play video. Or not.
Hey everyone, this is Zach from iStrategy Labs, and we're back with our latest experiment, the selfie. The self-enhancing live feed image engine. The selfie is constructed using a two-way mirror, a webcam, and LEDs that are embedded behind the mirror. Inside, we have a Mac Mini powering the facial recognition software, and an Arduino controlling the LEDs. Let's take it for a spin.
Put that in their house. That would be kind of weird. You went to your friend's house and they had me like, Well, enough of the selfies already. Like, can you really not do that? We built it because companies are always trying to get you to post photos when you're in their store or of their products, and so we ended up selling these to people like Bud Light, right? So beer company, when they do their events, the Today Show. So when celebrities go, they're in the like green room, it's called, before they go on TV, they're doing that picture. Land's End, which is a clothing company, which you probably don't have here. They're not international. It's likely, you know, the Gap. You probably know the Gap.
Yeah.
Abercrombie. Yes. It's like a little bit older. Like people who are a little bit older, like Land's End. Or like J. Crew. J. Crew? It's a head-to-head competitor, J. Crew. So we build these mirrors, and I know this is recording. We sell them for an average of like $50,000, maybe $75,000. It costs us about $2,000 for the parts. And we do this in like 2 days. Not a bad deal. So going from weird prototype of some idea that's either stupid or not, putting it on the internet, seeing if the internet likes it. And then if the internet likes it, well, maybe we take it forward and turn it into a product. So we've sold dozens of these now. This is how you go from idea to product in very short order without investors, right? And thankfully, we were able to invest in ourselves, but it didn't take a lot of money to make this. It certainly took a lot of talent, right? So the team is really smart, they know what they're doing, we can shoot this video ourselves. Not that it's the most amazing video in the world, but it doesn't have to be. That's the other thing, which was like, we're not gonna go crazy. Like, let's just make the thing and shoot the thing and put the thing on the internet. And if it's good, because everyone's responding, let's monetize it. So that's very much our approach for a lot of the things we do. So I'll pause here and let's just talk. So questions about anything, I'm an open book. So questions about how we do what we do, questions about creating the company, questions about stuff. What do you got?
How do you get inspired?
How do we get inspired to make? Yeah, I don't know that I need, I don't know that I need to. I feel like I'm constantly inspired, but the reason why is because I'm constantly meeting new people, and people deliver inspiration, right? So you probably, you like, read about Steve Jobs, right, or watch a video, or like Elon Musk, or something like that. I think they all very much inspire me. When I read about what Elon Musk is doing, I'm like, how am I such a loser? Why am I so dumb? Like, how did that ever happen? I always thought I was smart, but I guess I'm not. I thought I was dumb, but I guess I'm not. No, that's not a healthy way to think. And I thankfully, I get to travel a lot, right? So I've been to, I think, 74 or 5 countries now. I've done this, almost this exact kind of thing, in probably 30 or 35 like incubators and accelerators of some form. So realizing that anywhere in the world, there are creative people who are trying to do something new and different, keeps me inspired. If I came here and there wasn't this place, I'd be like, okay, Kosovo, yeah. But now I'm like, holy shit, Kosovo, this is cool, right? And I've had the opportunity to meet some great people in Pristina as well. Obviously not as great as here. I know that's recording, don't put it on YouTube. Okay, you can. So yeah, I think constantly interacting with people. And also I'll say, I read a tremendous amount. I probably read, I don't know, at least one or two books a month, and then probably 30 to 40 articles a day. So in the course of a month, I probably read 500 to 1,000 articles. And it's not only about technology, or only about creativity, or only about entrepreneurship. I'm reading about like foreign policy, and economics, and like, because that's, some of the underpinnings of the world are important. And you might find, like you could read something and go, oh wow, it looks like the European Commission is gonna spend $1 billion over the next 10 years to invest in agricultural technology and like energy savings. And oh, they're also gonna be like parceling off 100 million of that to the Balkans. I'd be like, how do I get that? Because I wanna do a startup here to grow bigger tomatoes, right? You can't be inspired to create the world's best like hydroponic tomato factory unless you get that like seed of insight. So read your faces off. I'm sure this will be unpopular, but I'll say it anyway because I don't know how not to say what I'm thinking. Watching TV is the biggest waste of your human existence. So if you find yourself watching 3 to 10 hours of football a week, read some stuff and make some stuff. And what I'd like to say is that you're either going to spend your life watching other people perform. The guy with the Adidas jacket is really, he's giving me like the evil eye.
Love my polo, bro.
You're either gonna spend your life watching other people perform, watching people perform on TV or on YouTube, or in real life, or you are gonna be the one performing. So be the one to perform. Stop celebrating the other people that are performing. Be the one. Learn the things of other people. Go ahead.
You can watch Mr. Robot. You might learn a thing or two. I know it's a contradiction.
I'll be honest. Like, I wouldn't want you only to watch Mr. Robot or only watch TV. The reality is, as a human, we need a release from reality. Reality can suck, right? My life hasn't been all, you know, rainbows and unicorns, and I have an amazing job, but sometimes it's not easy. And so if I want to escape, yeah, you know what? I'm probably going to watch Mr. Robot or Stranger Things. I don't know if you guys are watching Stranger Things.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. So scared. I must have been scared the other night. Such a great show. Anyhow, so go ahead.
Thank you, Peter. Thank you very much for the presentation.
Yeah.
It's really inspiring. I recently read Steve Case's Third Wave, the book.
Yeah.
Where he talks about the third wave and and after this moment, I was missing the typical model of a company to represent the third wave, so I already have that thanks to the presentation. ISL is the embodiment, I think, of a third wave company. So thank you.
My pleasure. Thank you for saying so. I saw a hand back there, and then I'll come up here. Go ahead.
What's the best advice for entrepreneurs?
I have a lot of advice for entrepreneurs. The reality is that entrepreneurs are a very diverse group of people, so giving one blanket piece of advice is hard. Like, you as an entrepreneur here versus me as an entrepreneur in the US versus a woman entrepreneur in Calcutta, India, like I give different advice to everybody. So, if you want advice for you?
Yeah.
What do you love?
I love trading in the stock market.
Cool, okay. Do you know how to program? Okay, so I would encourage you to learn Python. And you can just go on, listen, you literally can just go on the internet and do the world's simplest tutorial for Python. And the reason why I encourage you to learn Python is because all of the algorithmic traders, the high frequency traders, you probably read a little bit about high frequency trading, they use Python to write all the algorithms to do all the automated trading. So if you were the guy in Jacoba who knew more about Python programming and more about algorithmic trading, I'm pretty sure you could probably get any finance job in this country and or Europe or maybe the US. So if you love that, and I think it's a cool thing to love, be careful, because it's a good way to lose a lot of money. It's also a good way to make a lot of money. It's a casino, but I think that programmers are the ones that build the casino. So build a casino using Python.
I don't think that stock market is a casino. I think that is a game of propaganda.
Yeah, you're gonna do great. You already get it, right? You already get it. Have you read the book Flash Boys?
I read the book Think Like Millionaires.
Think Like Millionaires. So read Flash Boys. This is a really good book. I think you'll like it. And then there's another one. What did I read it recently? It's this. I'll have to remember and I'll come back to you on that one. And I'm going to go here and then I'll come back over. Go ahead.
Well, did you start your experience like Hacker, Black Hat, or White Hat, or Programmer, or what?
Yeah. There's another category, which is Script Kiddie, which you may be aware of. I was like 9. I was 9 or 10 years old. So I was just trying to get my hands on anything that let me do something. And again, this being on the record, I'll be careful fully with what I say. You know, I did all the shit that you do when you're a dumb kid, right? I downloaded pirated software. You know, I hacked things I shouldn't have hacked. Steve Case, who lives in Washington, D.C., and I've gotten to know pretty well, and I interviewed on stage in front of 1,000 people. He's the founder of AOL. I said to Steve, I have to apologize. He said, why? I said, well, I hacked AOL for years, and I stole all of the access. I never paid a dollar to you. And he's like, well, I'm glad it helped you, because it seems like you turned out well. He said, Mark Zuckerberg did the same thing. I was like, okay, cool. Mark and I have done the same thing. So I did all that. I guess I'll just admit, I downloaded a lot of software to teach myself. You know, I downloaded Photoshop, I downloaded Illustrator. I'm not encouraging you to steal software. That would be an irresponsible thing for you to do. But it was crucial to me. Now, I will say, by the way, my company spends thousands of dollars a month on license fees for Adobe. I became one of the best customers. Okay, Adobe, if you're watching. So yeah, I wouldn't put it as white hat or black hat. I was certainly not black hat. I wasn't trying to break anything or hurt anybody. I was probably gray hat, right? Like trying to learn. And I would say, if you're really into hacking, essentially like penetrating systems, what an incredible career you'll have. That is in the highest demand you can imagine. Information security professionals, you'll have a job right out of school, you'll make tremendous amounts of money, you have really hard challenges, the world needs information security professionals. I mean, half the internet basically got taken down yesterday by webcams. Did you read about this?
Yeah.
Botnets. Insane, the botnets, they're coming for us. They are coming for us. So I saw a hand over here. You've asked the question already. I'll get back to you unless there was another one. Go ahead.
I know you talked about entrepreneurship, but what is your advice on putting my, or should I say, presenting my brand to the world? Mm. Or the internet?
Your personal brand.
Yeah.
I've been very, very effective at that, and I think it's really important for some people. And it may be important to you. The easiest thing to do is to create content that people want to read or watch, right? So if you're really passionate, are you passionate about anything specifically? Is there something you love?
I'm interested in art or
3D design. 3D design, okay. So if it's 3D design, what I would do is I'd become the best 3D designer I could, and then I'd write a lot of tutorials for people like me who are learning. And it turns out that if you do that, the magic of the internet is they will come and they will find this thing and they will read it and share it, and all of a sudden, like over time, if you're really good at writing those tutorials and really good at that 3D design thing, you're gonna become like the foremost expert in that in this region, and then hopefully the world, and all of a sudden you're getting invitations to speak at, you know, 3D design conferences because you made a, you know, a 3D design of Trump's face that you can kick, and then everybody's so happy. You should do that. Like, that would be great. Why not? Right? So that last part, actually, I know is just kind of funny, but the other piece is to figure out what does the world want to see. So that's the marketing part. So you may need to create content. You may need to write blog posts. You may need to make tutorials. But if they're just tutorials of like making a cube, right? But right now the world wants to punch Donald Trump in the face. So let's make the 3D model animated into that, right? So tapping into like the real-time spirit of the world, there's this Latin phrase called the spiritus mundi. It's this idea that there is a like collective consciousness that we all sort of share. It's the stuff we're all thinking about right now. And so if you can tap into that, you'll create really interesting things, and the world will come to you. What else? Go ahead.
Yeah, from a marketing standpoint, I have actually two questions.
Yeah.
How do you make a Raspberry Pi Air or selfies viral?
Yeah.
And how, actually, what do you think about vlogs, video logs?
Vlogs. How do I make it viral? So the first thing is, we've been experimenting for a long time, and through the course of experimenting, we learned like how ideas spread. And that's very much my job, right, to do that. People pay us a lot of money to do that. For our own experiments, we built something called the PiPal, which is an internet-connected device that if you hit the button, pizza shows up at your house. Pretty cool. There was, like, we started with the premise that ordering pizza was too complicated. Not that it is not. Assuming you have pizza delivery, right? Everyone can go down the street and buy a pizza. But man, I don't want to burn any calories going down the street to get pizza. I don't want to burn any, like, oh, God. So we said, can we, like, one touch, pizza shows up. So we did a little Arduino and some LEDs, and we used Phantom.js as a framework to like automate a logging in to Domino's. I don't think you have Domino's here. It's not very good though. Don't ever eat it. Which logs you into the account, chooses the last order that you ordered with the credit card information and the address, and then sends it to you. And so when we launched that, that was the first experiment we really launched. Like it really took off. Like tens of thousands of people were watching this video, and we're like, how did this happen? So we dug in. And I saw that we had posted a blog post on iStrategy, and then I tweeted it out. And I don't have a huge amount of Twitter followers, but I have some. And one of my followers is an editor at O'Reilly Media, which you probably know is the sort of computer programming publisher, all the books about how to learn how to program, things like that. There's a quote by Tim O'Reilly, the founder, on the wall downstairs. And it turned out that Laura had retweeted me, and one of her followers was a journalist at CNET. And she wrote a blog post about PayPal. And then CNET, because it's a tech publication, the tech publications all write about what each other are writing about. So she wrote it, and then everyone else wrote like 100 blog posts, Mashable, Ars Technica, Wired, etc. And so when we looked at her, wow, I wonder if CNET wrote about our next thing. Would that happen again? So we built the selfie. I sent a tweet to the journalist, and it happened again. Right? And so now, when we launch something, we usually talk to a couple of the tech publications, literally just tweet the blog post. I'm like, hey, check it out. You might like this. You liked PayPal. Maybe you like selfie. And they did. So that's how it didn't go viral. What was the other question?
Video
blogs. You know, that's first of all sort of an old term. Right, so blogging is sort of the thing. Now it's more like just like being a YouTube influencer, I guess, is more the phrase. And it's not about any platform except for really YouTube. So back in the day, I know there were a lot of things you could use. Well, I think about it, I think that if you could become influential on YouTube, you'll make a lot of money. We spend hundreds of thousands of dollars a year paying YouTube influencers to do campaigns with us. How do you build that? Frankly, I've never built it, so I don't know. I'm not a YouTube influencer. The company is not one. The easiest answer would be create great content that people want to see. It just so happens that there are certain categories that kind of explode more than others. I'll tell you what they are. So music is number one. So I was meeting with this team, Intermedia, and Christina, you probably know that, right? God, one of their artists has like 200 million views after 2 months. This is insanity. And her song is good too. I mean, it's like they just know what they're doing. Actually, that's what I would do. I would literally go hang out with the Intermedia crew and be like, how are you doing what you're doing? So music is big. I like to call it dumb human tricks. Like people hurting themselves. Right? I don't encourage you to hurt yourself so that you get views on YouTube. But what you could do is repackage content that's on YouTube. So if I were 16 years old in 2016, screwing around and I wanted to have a big YouTube followership, I would be looking at that stuff and I'd be repackaging it, reposting to my channel until I built a big enough audience, and then I'd make my own original content. The other ones are relevant, obviously, like beauty and makeup. How many girls watch makeup tutorials on YouTube? Every single one, I would assume. You could do that too. Yeah, so I guess my best advice is all you have to do is sit and look at what is popular and then literally dissect it. Just like dissect it and you'll start to understand it. So we do that kind of dissection when we're trying to figure out how to get something to spread. We just don't own YouTube channels. What else? I thought I saw other hands.
What should I do? Because I'm 16 years old and I have a budget of money. So I don't have money and I want to start a business. What's the best idea to start a business with no money?
Yeah. Do you have a computer?
Yeah.
Teach yourself to program.
Number one. And make money.
Number one. Teach yourself to program. So you have to, if you don't have money, the asset that you have, the only asset that you have is yourself. So you have to make yourself more valuable. So if you train yourself to be a a Python engineer or an iOS engineer or a Ruby engineer or whatever that is, then go on TopTal or TopCoder or Desk.com or any of the outsourced programming platforms and start picking up jobs. And you can make 10 to 20 euro an hour building small web applications. And over time, you'll make a few hundred euro or a few thousand euro, and you go, wow, I made 5,000 euro this year, like programming over the internet for people. And now I'm going to take that money and do something else with it. Anybody can do that. If your brain works, you can do that, right? And that's not new. That's not like a revolutionary thing. What it will take is incredible hard work and focus. It'll take a lot less watching football, a lot less hanging out with your friends, which are two really fun activities, really amazing activities, and a lot more staring into a computer screen, entering the matrix. That's my best advice. And anyone can do that anywhere in the world, and that is the magic of the internet.
So if I am a good programmer and I don't have that budget to promote myself in the fan page to reach my profile, like 2,000 likes, 3,000 likes,
yeah.
What is the best advice that I can do with no money?
Yeah. So you on platforms like TopCoder and TopTal,
yeah.
You don't have to pay to promote yourself, right? It's free. You sign up, you post your profile. If it were me, I'd get really good at programming, and then I'd start to contribute to open source frameworks. So I'd find a couple popular projects, maybe like Drupal, if I was a PHP programmer, and I'd say, I'm gonna contribute to the modules of Drupal. I'm gonna make the world's best YouTube plugin for Drupal, and I'm gonna post it to the project that everyone's sharing there. And all of a sudden, like if it's really good, thousands of people are gonna download it. And they're gonna find out about it, and I put a donate button. Like I built this thing for free, it's open source, if you love it, send me 10 euros. And now I'm gonna do people actually value that enough? Did they send me 10 euros? Or I go to something like Tumblr, and if I'm a designer now, so I've been talking about engineering, right? Anyone a designer here, or wanna be one? I go to Tumblr, I create some Tumblr themes, and I sell them for 5 euros. And I put them in the store. Same thing with Shopify. Does anyone know about Shopify? You turn that on. Shopify has templates that people buy for 5 or 10 euros. And so I designed a Shopify template so that someone could run their e-commerce store. I know people that have made tens of thousands of dollars because they designed a nice Shopify template and they put it on it. This isn't hard. This just takes like focus and it takes time. What else? I'm probably almost out of time. Go ahead. I feel like it's blurring. I feel like I have a lot more control over the internet than I have over real life. You know? I don't know which one is safer, because they're both kind of interesting. I think the reality is they're merging. And they're not merging as fast as I thought they would, but with VR and augmented reality, that's accelerating. So, I'm not like big into forecasting the future, but it's easy enough to say that about 10 years from now, we're gonna spend not half the time, but maybe 25% of our time in a virtual reality. And that's either good or bad. That might be a good thing, that might be a bad thing. Have you used Oculus yet? Has anyone in the room used VR goggles? Right, has anyone used HTC Vive? Holy
Jesus Christ. That's because the mail doesn't really.
I know, I get it. And I only used it for the first time 2 weeks ago. And it changed my perspective on shit. Like in a real, real way. I didn't want to take the goggles off. I didn't. And that was scary, actually. It was like,
I would rather be in here than I would out here. When I was in college, I fortunately decided I wanted to learn how to produce content. I wanted to shoot a documentary, and I wanted to trick my teachers and give me credit for it. So I did. And so what I did was I interviewed successful people all over the US, asking them, like, how did you become successful? And almost every single one of them, it all boiled down to their ability to block the noise in the world, which there's a tremendous amount of noise, and then tune up the signal. And I'll tell you what the noise and the signal are. The noise is mostly your friends and your parents saying, you shouldn't do this, you shouldn't do that. If you do this, you're stupid, and that's a stupid idea, and that's never gonna work, and on and on and on and on. Or you should be a doctor, you should be a lawyer, you should be work in the government, or whatever. Which is all noise. So if you can start to realize, first of all, that your world is full of noise, that's the first step. And then you can hear the noise. And you're like, oh, God, it's noisy. Let me leave that over here for a second. Where's the signal? And the signal is, like, you know, maybe just before you go to bed, or like just when you're waking up. It's like the thing that you keep thinking about, which is like, you know, I really love to do makeup tutorials on YouTube.
I don't know. Maybe that's it. Maybe it's not.
Or I'd really love to just, God, I want to cure cancer. Or, like, I just want to open a Borat shop. This is probably not the thing. And so you'll start to hear what you truly want. Block the noise, and then tune out what it is that you truly want. And once you do that, you become brave enough to ignore all the noise. So growing up, I was a kid that, I always had a lot of friends that I liked people, I was popular, but my friends would say, Peter, that's a crazy idea. You can't do that, that's crazy. And it really frustrated me. I got really kind of upset by that. Eventually, I learned about this, like noise versus signal thing, and I realized that I wasn't crazy, they were scared. It's not you who's, they're scared that you're going to outshine them and be successful, and it may force them to get the fuck off the couch. Right? So I would suggest, block all that bullshit and tune up that signal in your own brain and go after it. There is nothing to be afraid of. Anyway, that's a good way to end. Thank you guys so much. It's been really good.
Thank you to New York. Thank you for coming. We have a cocktail outside. Whoever wants to get more information about BONEVET courses and everything else, we have our sample on it here. Thank you once again.